Please be seated. We have an early start. For those of you who weren't here yesterday, I'm Nathan Tarcov, director of the Leo Strauss Center of the University of Chicago, and welcome you to our conference on Leo Strauss as teacher. Our first panel, well, I'll stay here for another minute then, is a continuation, in some sense, of yesterday's panel with former students and assistants of Leo Strauss, representing later years, Abram Shulsky, who studied with Strauss at the University of Chicago 64 to 67, and then for a semester at Claremont, Richard Zinman, who studied with him Strauss's entire year and a half at Claremont, and Ted Blanton and Jerry Caplan, who attended his classes and assisted him at St. John's College. I myself studied with him at Claremont Graduate School in 1968-69 and attended two classes for which the tapes have not been located, so I can make up anything I want about what transpired in them, and somehow persuaded him to give me a tutorial on Xenophon, which certainly was not taped. Dr. Shulsky received his PhD in political science from the University of Chicago. He is a senior fellow at the Hudson Institute. He served as, if I have the title right, special advisor to the Undersecretary of Defense for Policy from 2001 to 2009. And I hope I get this one right. And he is the author of the much-quoted article on intelligence, Leo Strauss and intelligence, I don't mean noose. Is that right?
Something like that, yeah.
Sometimes quoted for good or ill. Dr. Shulsky.
Okay, thank you. It's never been quoted for good, I can assure you. It occurs to me, as Nathan mentioned, that the tapes for the Claremont courses have never been found, and it might be that that's actually my fault indirectly. When I was driving from Chicago to Los Angeles in January of 68 to... you know, I'd finished my coursework here, and I wanted to be out in California, partly because if you've been in Chicago in January, you know why you'd prefer to be in California, but also because Leo Strauss was going to be teaching at Claremont in that spring semester. And I got it was called a driveway car back then. I don't know if they still do that, where you can just drive someone else's car. And among the things I was carrying along with the owner's golf clubs were the tape recorder and that was being sent out to Claremont, I guess, because Herb Storing thought maybe they didn't have this technology out in Southern California yet, and he wanted to make sure we had it. So anyway, as I was traversing the Texas Panhandle and stopped at the one traffic light in this one traffic light town, someone rear-ended me at about 35 miles an hour, and that destroyed, among other things, the tape recorder. So
you are absolved. The courses were taped on a different tape recorder.
Okay, well then it's
and
not
the
my
first
fault.
One. The one you attended was preserved and transcribed.
Oh, I see. Okay, well then it's
the two I attended have disappeared.
Then I'm well, at least in that case, I'm in the clear. Good. You know, those of us who have studied with Leo Strauss have had this very strange experience in the last 10 years of reading and hearing in the media about a Leo Strauss who bears no resemblance to the teacher we remember. And to put the matter simply, the media Strauss was a kind of political activist. According to one article, he was even a key factor in Newt Gingrich's contract with America in 1994, which of course was over 20 years after his death. This interpretation will be belied, of course, by the transcripts now being made public, but I wouldn't hold your breath waiting for any corrections to the records. As I was a graduate student here, as Nathan mentioned, from 64 to the end of 67, and of course, politically, this was a very feverish period. The civil rights movement was very active and a very important part of political life. And of course, the war in Vietnam became increasingly controversial during that period. But there was almost no mention of these issues in Strauss's classes. For example, the only specific mention of Vietnam that I can remember was that Strauss had this sort of jocular description of the difference between liberals and conservatives. He said the former liberals were against the war in Vietnam, the latter conservatives were against the war on poverty. His point, of course, was to say how similar liberals and conservatives in the American context were if you looked in the light of the full spectrum of political possibilities. The only explicit expression of a political opinion related to an event in the news that I can remember is a short statement that Strauss made in January 1965, rendering homage to Winston Churchill, who had just died. Even in this statement, which one could argue took a political stance, although hardly a controversial one, a key point was that a political science worthy of the name had to be able to recognize greatness in a statesman when it sees it. Which brings me to an important characteristic of Strauss's teaching from the period, at least, that I knew him. His insistence on justifying his activity in front of a tribunal of political science, of the political science profession. One could easily imagine that Strauss would have become a member of a philosophy department instead of a political science department, given what he did. I don't know why he ended up where he did. And in particular, I don't know if it was by accident or by choice that he was in a political science department. But nevertheless, he took that situation seriously, however it came about. And his defense of his activity always included a discussion of why political philosophy, which we can sort of provisionally think of at least as the search for the best regime, is now generally regarded as impossible. He attributed this to the intellectual dominance of relativism or positivism on the one hand and historicism on the other. Strauss's typical course during this period involved a close study of one or maybe a few texts, which meant that he didn't spend a great deal of time arguing against these other schools of thought, the relativism and historicism. But instead, his remarks tended to be more defensive in nature. In other words, he was directed at justifying his activity in the light of the predominant views in the political science department. My period of study here at University of Chicago corresponded in a way with a high point of behavioralism, quantitative work, in the political science profession. It was a relatively new movement at the time, and it was not only advancing its status within the profession, but it was extremely optimistic that it was sort of on the brink of making major advances in the study of political matters. So it had a kind of, I don't know, not a, well, sort of aggressive, but at least a kind of crusading spirit in a sense that it doesn't have anymore. In any way, with respect to relativism, Strauss would usually make a few comments indicating that matters weren't as simple as often presented, especially in terms of the fact-value distinction. One of his examples was the example of a smoker who wished to quit smoking. This may be a little autobiographical in his case, I don't think he wished to, but was told to. But in any case, for such a person, is smoking his value, because that's, after all, what he does, and if you want to be scientific, you should look at what he does, and so forth. Or is non-smoking his value, since that is what he says he aspires to, although he doesn't quite achieve it. I mean, the example, and this is sort of typical, we mentioned this, speakers mentioned this yesterday, of how simply Strauss would approach a question like this, and it seems simple, maybe even simplistic. But if you reflect on this a little bit more, you get into the whole question of, well, what is the soul, and how is it, you know, what are the parts of the soul, and so forth and so on. I mean, a lot of the issues that are dealt with in, say, the Republic would come up if you just thought about that a little bit more carefully. Whereas if you just sort of adopted, well, there's values and facts, that kind of obscures the fact that the values part may not be clear at all. Anyway, the reigning orthodoxy stated it you know, the situation is political science can't tell you what objectives to pursue, because those would be the values, of course. But given your objectives, it can tell you what you should do to attain them, i.e. those will be facts of a causal sort. Do X, or if X is done, then Y follows, that kind of thing. But Strauss would point out that the same study of history, which showed that people had different values at different times, which was, of course, one of the arguments for relativism, showed that they understood science and causality differently at different times as well. Strauss noted that up-to-date philosophers of science, such as Ernest Nagel in the course that we were discussing yesterday, were led or forced to admit that the choice of one era's science over another era's science was also fundamentally arbitrary. In other words, our belief in modern notions of causality could be determined by the historical epoch in which we lived. Now, of course, that raises a lot of interesting questions to the argument that modern science, you know, is distinguished by what it can achieve, after all, as opposed to other kinds of science. You know, Aristotle's notion of final causes, which doesn't seem to lead to any real product or fruit. Strauss noted that, in a way, given the development of nuclear weapons and things of that nature, the jury was still out on the question of whether this was really a bringer of good. In any case, this necessarily then led to the discussion of historicism. At this point, he would usually point out that one couldn't understand one's own epoch without understanding its roots in previous epochs. To understand a previous epoch meant to understand it in its own terms, i.e. as those people understood it at the time, as the main thinkers of that period understood it, rather than from our own perspective. And that meant approaching the thought of the past without assuming from the outset that precisely because it was historical, it couldn't be true. In other words, those people obviously thought it was true. Strauss did give one course in my time at the University of Chicago, the course that we discussed a little bit yesterday, dealing with these predominant views head on. His approach, again, was historical, starting with the work of Auguste Comte. And again, his manner was to speak very straightforwardly, avoiding any kind of jargon. I must confess that in reviewing the transcript in preparing for this conference, I realized that I was in a little way fooled or just put to sleep, perhaps, by the simplicity of the way in which he described it. And I realized that I missed an awful lot the first time I heard that course. So it was very interesting to be able to reread it again the other week when I was preparing this. His key point, again, was that his positivism necessarily led to historicism, which Strauss saw as the much more important school of thought that was an opponent of the rebirth of political philosophy in the classical sense. Historicism, however, seemed like this dead end. It's at the same time saying that it had discovered some sort of trans-historical truth, i.e. that all truth is relative to the epoch that it occurs in, yet at the same time denying such a truth could exist. So, as is well known, Strauss's response to this situation was to turn to the history of political philosophy and basically to see whether our journey into this dead end of historicism was really a result of necessity. Did it come about, you know, inevitably from the beginnings of in ancient Greece, or was it perhaps the result of some questionable choices along the way? Given this approach, Strauss generally preferred, as I said, only to make a short defense of his activity, plunging right into the texts. And I think that was sort of the key of his notion of teaching, because with the texts themselves, he could rely on the real attractiveness of the discussion of real political moral questions and the charm of the texts themselves. And in a way, this meant that at least for some period of time, the students could put aside a lot of these epistemological doubts or problems and simply discover the richness of the political philosophy tradition for themselves. And I think Strauss may have felt that a fuller understanding of these texts was necessary before one could even come to grips with the problems posed by historicism and positivism. In the case of historicism, I think it's pretty clear. I mean, until you really learned how to read an old text and read between the lines, as we mentioned before, you couldn't really see the full extent to which a thinker at a given time may have really deviated from the common opinion of his time. I mean, the notion that everyone is determined by their times is obviously going to be furthered if you only look at a surface in which an author is deliberately paying deference to the opinions of his time because he doesn't want to have to drink hemlock or because he doesn't want to be persecuted or just because he doesn't want to upset people unnecessarily and he doesn't want to disturb the political order to no purpose. And also, I think he might have felt that these theories of positivism and historicism would seem much more powerful in the concrete than they would seem in, I mean, much more powerful in the abstract than they would seem in a concrete circumstance. You know, it's easy if you're raised in a scientific culture to think, well, of course, values can't be proved. They're all sort of arbitrary or equal. Nevertheless, when you look at Aristotle's Politics, and at one point he sort of sets as a standard of the goodness of a regime the fact that it has both avoided tyranny and civil strife, it's a little hard to argue with that. I mean, that seems like an obviously reasonable standard to apply to a regime, to ask whether it can do that. So in that way, I think he thought that it would produce a much more richer understanding for the students. And then if they wanted to go back and engage on the great, you know, sort of philosophic battlefields, they would at least know what they were talking about. Let me just close with a brief reflection on Strauss's own description of his approach to teaching, this very famous statement that he made. He said, "Always assume that there's one silent student in your class who is by far superior to you in head and in heart." And he explains this in Liberalism, Ancient and Modern by saying, "I meant by this, do not have too high an opinion of your importance, but have the highest opinion of your duty and responsibility." But I'd like to suggest perhaps something, another possible understanding, that Strauss recognized that while his return to classical political philosophy, as I mentioned, was sort of necessary to see how it evolved and how it led us into this seeming dead end, it might not be sufficient. In other words, his reviving the possibility of understanding classical political philosophy might have weakened the evidence for historicism, but it didn't really refute or transcend it. And it didn't really account for the effectiveness of modern science in terms of a human mastery of nature, whether for good or for evil. I mean, as he pointed out, it could be evil, but even so, it's still kind of impressive. I think he sought to reestablish the possibility of philosophizing, but it was he characteristically saw the enduring questions as more evident than their answers. Hence, it perhaps could have remained for that one silent student to carry on his work. Thank you.
Richard Zinman is University Distinguished Professor of Political Theory at James Madison College, Michigan State University. And as I mentioned before, received his PhD in government from Claremont Graduate School, which you will be hearing about. He's the editor of many volumes, and long, long ago wrote one of the first serious papers on Strauss's thought for an APSA convention, which he has carefully refrained from publishing. Dick?
Well, let me say that I refrained from publishing it on the advice of Harvey Mansfield, who, when he read it, said, "Well, this is very good, but it will ruin your career." First of all, I want to thank Nathan for inviting me. It was particularly brave of him to invite me, since at Claremont I saw him in his cups more than once. But I won't say anything about that.
That's impossible. The drinking age in California was then 21, so you must be mistaken.
You must have misunderstood.
And Nathan was only 14. Strauss arrived in Claremont in January 1968, and he left at the end of the summer of 1969. He was only there for a year and a half. And while he was there, he taught only three courses, a course on Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics, a course on Plato's Apology and Crito, and then selections from Xenophon's Memorabilia, and then a course on Rousseau's First and Second Discourse and the Social Contract. During much of the time Professor Strauss was in Claremont, I was his research assistant. Now, that was my official title, but I'm sure that many in the room know that Strauss never had a research assistant, never used a research assistant, and therefore, in fact, I was his manservant. I sometimes would think of our relationship as an update of the relationship with between Worcester and Jeeves, with the roles somewhat reversed, at least insofar as, I'm sure you all know this, that Jeeves' favorite philosopher was Spinoza. In my case, I had never read Spinoza, and Strauss was a great master of Spinoza. At other times, I'd like to think of our relationship as Strauss was an officer in the German army in World War I, and I was his Batman. This whole period was an unhappy time for Mr. Strauss and for Mrs. Strauss as well. It was a time of dislocation. I'm in no position to compare the impact of the dislocation of moving from Berlin to Paris, to London, to New York, to Chicago, but moving to Claremont was a very big dislocation. If you can imagine Leo Strauss in the land of the lotus eaters. It was also a time of great, I use the Yiddish term, a great serious troubles for the Strausses. When I was asked to give this talk, I realized I would be preceded by many distinguished colleagues, some of whom knew Strauss much better than I did. So, of course, I decided to appeal to the muses. When I did appeal to the muses, I teach at Michigan State. We're the Spartans. We have giant statue of a Spartan warrior. The campus is filled with little grottos to the Greek gods and goddesses. So I went to the Grotto of the Muses, and I explained why I needed help, and the answer was, Strauss, worse than a Philistine, completely amusical. His favorite art, when I knew him, was the TV show Gunsmoke, followed only by the TV show Family Affair. Now, Gunsmoke I could understand, but Family Affair, I mean, it's true that Buffy was very cute, but beyond that, and that really was how Mr. Strauss spent his leisure time, watching things like Gunsmoke and Family Affair. Give you a sense of Mr. Strauss as my teacher, let me begin with a story. And it's a story about the student uprising at Columbia University, which took place April and May 1968. Some of you may remember a famous picture of David Shapiro, one of the leaders of the Columbia uprising, in President Grayson Kirk's office, wearing sunglasses and smoking a cigar with his legs up on the president's desk. And at the same time, other colleagues were holding the provost hostage. So this was a very serious matter. You also may remember, may I say an improper word? Yes. Okay. Some of
we're talking about the free speech movement. You're being taped.
Yeah. Some of you may remember the slogan of the Columbia students, "Up against the wall, motherfucker." Now, Mrs. Strauss was mildly interested in sort of current events, but he was quite interested in what was happening on the campuses. I'll come back to this later. And one day I walked into his office in the midst of this uprising, and he said with this very quizzical smile on his face, "Is it true, Mr. Zinman, that the Columbia students are using the Oedipus word in public?" Now, Mr. Strauss was, at least in public, a very proper man, and would never say the Oedipus word in public. And he really was, on the one hand, he was appalled, but on the other hand, he was also sort of interested. And he when he asked me this question, I drew a complete blank. "The Oedipus word?" And I said, "Mr. Strauss, I don't understand what you mean." And he said, "You know, the Oedipus word." And we went on like this for about 5 minutes. I was humiliated by not knowing the Oedipus word. But I really didn't know the Oedipus word. And it was only days later that I realized what the Oedipus word was. Well, that was more or less Strauss's effect on me as a teacher. He would teach me something important, I would be obtuse about it, and then there would be a long delay and I would understand. Let me talk first about Strauss as a public teacher at Claremont. And I do want to distinguish between Strauss as a public teacher and as a private teacher. A private teacher meaning a teacher of me. I don't want to speak for anyone else, although there are others at Claremont who could speak certainly equally well about this. I remember that it was a huge surprise, even a shock, when the graduate students at Claremont were told that Professor Strauss had been appointed and would arrive in a couple of weeks to begin the new spring semester. After all, it was a small group of graduate students, but almost all of us, including me, I had gone to Claremont to study American political thought primarily with Martin Diamond, Harry Jaffa, Douglas Adair. Just so happens that when I was there, another very fine and but somewhat crazy teacher arrived, Harry Newman, who you may not know, but from whom I learned a great deal. And most of us had been there a time. I'd been there 2.5 years, and it was just unclear. I mean, it was wonderful that Professor Strauss was coming, but it was unclear what this meant. I mean, was our whole orientation going to change? It also was unclear what this was going to mean for our partying. Because, after all, I mean, what did Professor Strauss drink? And I mean, there were some serious, very high-level parties at which I would say the most common subject were Professor Strauss's books. Well, this was not going to continue if Professor Strauss was going to. And even more important, we had, this was, remember, early in the American experience of wine drinking. We had discovered wine, but we thought good wine was something called vino primo. So I remember very well a party that we had for Mr. and Mrs. Strauss and Jenny and Diskin soon after the Strausses arrived, and the terror of being at that party. I mean, we just didn't know what to do. I mean, do you go over and make small talk? Do you ask about the Dodgers? It was a very, very awkward and strange situation for us students. Strauss taught these three courses I mentioned. The context was different than it had been at the University of Chicago. First of all, it was a shift from teaching primarily graduate students to primarily teaching undergraduates. He was appointed at Claremont Men's College, which was an undergraduate college. He had no appointment in the graduate school, as far as I know. Of course, graduate students took his courses or sat on his courses, but the vast audience were undergraduates. In fact, Nathan, correct me, I remember being in a room where there might have been 150 students. I don't know how many people were enrolled, but it was a very large audience. Also, there was another change. I'm not sure how important this is. You could look at the tapes or the transcripts and see whether it mattered. It was a shift from the quarter system, where classes were 9 to 10 weeks long, to the semester system, where they were 15 weeks long. And my impression is that had some effect in that the courses were somewhat more leisurely, and there was lots and lots of room for questions. But the interesting thing to me was that the content and the format were the same as he had been had used at Chicago. There certainly was no dumbing down. I mean, he taught the courses the way, more or less, the way he taught them to graduate students at Chicago. Now, again, a careful study of the transcripts might reveal some changes, but I don't remember them. Now, these were very good courses, but I have to say that something was missing from them. And I couldn't tell at the time whether that was because of Mr. Strauss or whether it was because of me. Mr. Strauss took his teaching duties very seriously. He prepared carefully for each course. Each course session was well done. But I would say that his heart wasn't fully in it in the way it obviously once had been. I'll come back to why in a second. And then, of course, there was me. And it turned out, thinking back on it, that these courses didn't have the impact on me that I expected them to have because, well, let me give you a few reasons. My friend and colleague, former colleague Werner Danshauser, has written a wonderful essay, Becoming Naive Again, which I think someone referred to yesterday, to describe the effect that Strauss had on his Danhauser's generation of students. Well, I had already been made naive by my teachers at Cornell and at Claremont, who had been students of Strauss. But secondly, I had already unknowingly been corrupted by Mr. Strauss himself. That is, I had been poring over his books for at least 2.5 years. I'd been discussing them almost every day with friends. And remember, he had already published all of his books up through Liberalism, Ancient and Modern, the preface of which for which he wrote at Claremont. So there were only 3 more books to come. Secondly, I confess, I had read many of the transcripts. I worked for Professor Diamond. He gave me free access to the transcripts. I had, in fact, read transcripts on all the courses that Professor Strauss taught at Claremont before he taught the courses. And that, I think, had an impact on the way the courses affected me. And then one last thing, I blame Professor Gurevich for corrupting me. Because in September and December of 1968...
Time out.
You saw yesterday that Professor Gurevich is a great corrupter. But in September and December of 1968, he published a 2-part study of Strauss called Philosophy and Politics in the Review of Metaphysics. And this was, I must say, the first intelligent thing ever written about Strauss. And it was very intelligent. I was quite taken by it. This was in the middle of the time I spent working for Strauss. And it made me see with much greater clarity than I had before that, first of all, that Strauss was primarily concerned with philosophy as a way of life. And secondly, that he understood philosophy to be skeptical or zetetic. I also must say that Professor Gurevich, by writing intelligently, very intelligently on Strauss, made it possible for me later to write a dissertation on Strauss. But I do think that these three things, spending a lot of time with Strauss's books, reading transcripts before taking courses, and then reading Professor Gurevich on Strauss, really did mean that the experience of being in his classes for me was just different than I expected it to be, and less powerful. Let me talk for a few minutes about what I call the paradox of Strauss as a public teacher in Claremont. These were dark times, as Abe has suggested. There were dark times, both public and private. Strauss's time at Claremont coincided with what you could call the peak of the 60s. The Vietnam War, the anti-war movement, the Black Power movement, urban riots, the Prague Spring, international student revolt, the assassinations of Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy, President Johnson's decision not to run, the wild Democratic Party convention in Chicago, the bitter Humphrey-Nixon contest for the presidency. All of this happened in that year and a half. It was an extraordinary time. And even at Claremont, which was relatively insulated from student uprisings and revolution, we still had an active SDS contingent. One of the secretaries in the political science department at Pomona had her hand blown off when she opened a letter bomb that was intended for a professor. So we weren't completely insulated. And this was also a dark time for the Strausses. Mr. Strauss was repeatedly ill. He was in and out of the hospital. I spent many, many days visiting him at the hospital and bringing him books by the armload, many of which I had never heard of. I mean, this was not bedside reading. ancient texts by authors I literally had never heard of at the time were common. And Mrs. Strauss was ill and unhappy during this whole period. There was one moment, at least, when this private unhappiness and public unhappiness coincided, and that is a second story I have to tell, and this time about the student uprising at Cornell, which some people here were involved in. This was April 1969. And it began a few weeks after the student uprising at Harvard, and it ended 2 months before what at the time was a momentous event in the radical movement, that is, split of the Weathermen faction from SDS. And the Weathermen then went underground and became a terrorist group. I happen to have a friend who was one of them. Well, most of you remember the Cornell events involved an armed takeover by black students of the student union, and then a huge controversy about how the university should respond. Among the professors there were a number of Strauss's students, but especially Walter Burns and Alan Bloom. And one day I walked into Strauss's office, and Strauss was usually, no matter how ill, quite cheerful. And this day he was sitting at his desk with his head in his hands, almost wringing his hands, and he had just heard that Walter Burns had resigned from the faculty at Cornell. And of course he was deeply upset by what had happened at Cornell, what had happened at Columbia, what had happened at Harvard, because it really did look like this was the end of the American university. And even though he didn't have that high an opinion of the American university, still, it was a special institution. But on this day, it wasn't Cornell that disturbed him, it was Walter Burns' fate that disturbed him. And he turned to me and he said, Mr. Zinman, do you think that Mr. Burns resigned because of me, meaning because of what I had taught him? And I just didn't know what to say. I mean, if the answer was yes, but of course, it had something to do with Professor Burns' character, which was very distinctive. But he was just distraught at the thought that Walter Burns was out of a job. And Walter Burns had a family, and And of course, Strauss remembered all of the times he was out of a job or was had trouble looking for a job, and he didn't. It wasn't obvious to him that Professor Mertz was relatively quickly going to get another job. So it was a very touching, very poignant moment. Despite these dark times, and especially despite Strauss's illness and unhappiness, he was extraordinarily. He was extraordinarily resolute. His perseverance was just astounding to watch. He was extraordinarily productive at Claremont. Let me give you just some examples. I took, in the form of dictation from him, took down Xenophon's Socratic Discourse, the first, or the second book on Xenophon, but the first of the last two books. The aversion of the essay on the Euthydemus, aversion of the essay Philosophy as a Rigorous Science and Political Philosophy on Husserl and Heidegger. And then, although I didn't take dictation on this, he was already working on Xenophon's Socrates. So while he was struggling with illness, while he was struggling with all sorts of other problems, he was working away whenever he could with extraordinary persistence. Now let me say something about Strauss as a private teacher at Claremont. First about his deeds. For me, it was a great privilege and also, I must say, a great pleasure to just watch Strauss live. I was able to see what it meant to live the life of the mind. And I had some experience with this before, but very different. I mean, I had seen Alan Bloom's life. Now, now I don't know how many of you knew Alan Bloom well, but he did not live a life of quiet grandeur and noble simplicity. Strauss, in contrast, lived very simply. I would say almost aesthetically. I mean, it wasn't as if he lived naked in a barrel, but it was pretty close. He also lived with illness, with unhappiness, and with fear. It wasn't so much fear of death, although I don't think he was immune from that. It was fear of not being able to finish his work. I'll come back to that. But perhaps his illness and unhappiness made it even more necessary for him to live simply. He could, for example, for days on end, more or less lock himself in his study. Mrs. Strauss would bring meals to him on trays. He would take the tray in, he would eat it, then he'd put the empty tray out. But he'd never come out, and he would be in there writing for days. And, you know, this was, again, an older man who was not well. And he had the strength of soul to do this over sustained periods of time. It was just amazing to watch. At least it was amazing to me. He also lived between gravity and levity. He lived by unifying gravity and levity. And what I mean by that is, as Professor Walker says, he was a very serious man in some ways. As Professor Faulkner also said, he was impish. But it struck me, he definitely was, he was a great imp. And that also taught you something. But he had one marvelous comic sensibility that went, I think, beyond impishness. He really did unify gravity and levity in his person. And that was something to behold. But most importantly, I don't know how to say this, so I'll just stumble a bit. He lived a project. And what I mean by that is he made clear to me that he had work he wanted to finish before he died. And I'm sure he made this clear to others also. He wanted to finish his work on Xenophon. And he wanted to write a book on Plato's Laws. In fact, he said once that he thought he would write, the last thing he wrote would be a book on Plato's Laws, supposedly the last thing Plato wrote. And he was determined to do this. And he did, despite everything. And these, I would say these were great lessons for a young person to learn. But also, there were his speeches. And let me talk a little bit about those. First of all, he had recently published the preface to the Spinoza book and the essay on Lucretius. Both of them were republished in Liberalism and Ancients and Moderns, which came out just as he arrived in Claremont. And for me, these were eye-openers. They and a series of other things just introduced me to, in a way that I hadn't understood before, the radicalism of Strauss's thought. The preface to the Spinoza book introduced me and many others to his understanding of modern atheism early and late. His essay on Lucretius introduced us to his understanding of classical atheism. He also offered a private or semi-private reading course on the Euthydemus. Was it the summer after he got there?
The summer of 68.
And we were in that class. And I don't know how many have read the Euthydemus. It's a very strange and very funny dialogue. And Professor Strauss had a wonderful time teaching it. And it was, I don't want to say rollicking, but and it introduced us to Strauss's understanding of how complicated the problem of the relationship between Socrates and the sophists were, how close to being a sophist Socrates was, how funny the sophists were, how funny Socrates was. And this was a whole side of Strauss's study of the ancients, which was partly visible in his earlier work, especially Socrates and Aristophanes, but not when he talked about, not as much when he talked about Plato. And then he had written this book on the Economicus. And there, he just lays out in a very clear way the problem of the gentleman and the problem of the moral consciousness. Again, a very radical part of his thinking. And finally, there was the essay on Husserl and Heidegger. And for me, and many others, I think, this gave us access to Strauss's understanding of the European horizon of his own thought. We as Americans just didn't understand that horizon. And you couldn't understand that horizon by reading on tyranny or natural right and history, or you couldn't understand it adequately. And so suddenly it was very clear that, you know, we just had to read Being and Time. We had to read The Crisis of the European Sciences. That was the real horizon of Strauss's thought in some ways. And all of this I learned, or we learned, in a very short period of time during this year and a half. Finally, I'll say a word about the paradox of Strauss as a teacher simply. Doing one's duty to one's students clearly was important to him. But I don't think it was anywhere near the most important thing to him. First of all, Strauss taught what he had to teach. But he also did not teach what he could not teach and should not teach. And what do I mean by that? In teaching what he had to teach, Professor Shulsky and others have mentioned this, his audience, his primary audience, were graduate students in American departments of political science. What would his teaching career have looked like if he had taught in American department of philosophy? What would it have looked like if he had taught in Germany? Of course, we'll never know. But certainly his repertoire was determined, not exclusively, but largely by the fact that he took seriously being a member of the Department of Political Science. So what did he not teach that was clearly important to him? Well, with the exception of Nietzsche, as far as I can tell, he didn't teach the Germans of his youth and the Germans of his coming of age. He didn't teach Husserl. He didn't teach Heidegger. He didn't teach Lessing. He also didn't teach the medieval Muslims and Jews of his coming of age. He didn't teach Maimonides, although he did give lectures elsewhere. He didn't teach Farabi. But what does this mean? It means that if you look over the whole of Strauss's teaching career, he never taught his own teachers. I mean, who were his teachers in some ways? Farabi and Lessing. Now, he also, there were limits, I think, on his teaching that he placed on himself, or the nature of the subject matter placed on him. He didn't teach to anyone, as far as I can tell. For example, his considered judgment on the theological political problem. I mean, if you look at his career, the three books he wrote before he came to Claremont were Thoughts on Machiavelli, The City and Man, and Socrates and Aristophanes. All, but especially the Machiavelli book and Socrates and Aristophanes, were about the theological political problem. Thoughts on Machiavelli, in the way his book on the Bible, is certainly his book on Christianity. Socrates and Aristophanes, his book on the gods. I don't know how else to put it. And then after, or while in Claremont, he wrote Xenophon's Socratic Discourse, Xenophon's Socrates, and then The Argument and the Action of Plato's Laws. Well, Xenophon's Socratic Discourse and Xenophon's Socrates, I think, were above all, again, an exploration of the moral consciousness and its relationship to the religious consciousness. And The Argument and the Action of Plato's Laws is the book on Plato's book on prophecy. So he was consistently in his writing, not just concerned with, but I would say focused on, the theological political problem. But he said very, very little about that, almost nothing in the classroom. Certainly, you could go to his classes, like the class on the ethics, or the class that I went to, and that led me to write a dissertation on his interpretation of Aristotle, or the class on Xenophon's memorabilia, and you could see that he was deeply concerned with, you might say, the problem of the moral consciousness. But how he understood the relationship between the problem of the moral consciousness and the problem of the religious consciousness, and what that might mean for thinking through the theological, was, I would say, completely invisible in his teaching. His public teaching. Not in his books, but in his public teaching. So, let me end by recalling a couple of things that Strauss said about Thucydides, which I think illuminate his work. His essay on Thucydides, by the way, I think is one of his real masterpieces. If you want to learn how to read a book, that's a very good essay to study. In the concluding section of that essay, which he published in City and Man, after stating that, quote, it is evidently necessary to go beyond Thucydides towards the philosophers, Plato and Aristotle, and then adding, secondly, all this amounts to saying that Thucydides' thought is inferior to Plato's thought, Strauss asks a question, or could Thucydides have had a positive reason for stopping on his ascent earlier than Plato? Strauss goes on to answer his own question at the very end of that section, at the very end of the essay, at the very end of City and Man. Now, you have to be suspicious of anything Strauss says at the beginning of his books or the end of his books, but still. He says, I'm quoting now, "For what is first for us is not the philosophic understanding of the city, but that understanding of the city which is inherent in the city as such, in the pre-philosophic city, according to which the city sees itself as subject and subservient to the divine in the ordinary understanding of the divine, or looks up to it. Only by beginning at this point will we be open to the full impact of the all-important question, which is coeval with philosophy, although the philosophers do not frequently pronounce it." And then he says, the question, and there's a Latin phrase. The Latin phrase could be translated somewhat differently. What is a god? What would a god be? What should a god be? I'll leave it for you to decide. Strauss, I would say, appeared to stop on his ascent earlier than Plato and Aristotle. But in fact, as far as I can tell from reading his books, he stopped at the same place that Plato and Aristotle stopped. Finally, another thing he said about Thucydides. Only through becoming wise oneself can one recognize wisdom in others. Sobering thought. Wisdom cannot be presented as a spectacle in the way in which battles and the like can be presented. Wisdom cannot be said, quotation marks. It can only be done. Strauss did wisdom.
Professor Zinman's recollections of Claremont bring back days which I don't tend to think of as so dark, a happy time in my own life. He does provoke me to just say a couple of things. One is by way of confirmation or elaboration to just add how often he laughed in class, including at times when nobody else was doing so.
And he was also sometimes laughing at stupid questions asked by people like me.
No, he was extremely courteous with a couple of exceptions, one of which I mentioned yesterday. Also, no one has alleged this here, but I've sometimes heard it alleged that a very generous teacher, he was not generous in other respects, and I wish to contradict that calumny, because at the end, I think it was at the end of the Euthydemus group in the summer, in August of 68, he took the participants out to dinner. And again, to contradict another calumny uttered, when he served the wine, he asked one of the participants how old he was, and on discovering that I was still 20, refused to give me any wine, because he always wished to obey the laws, as he explained at the time. And I'll just say one more thing and then resume the proper order of this event, which is that, and here perhaps we disagree a little, it seemed to me that when he was teaching the Euthydemus in the summer, and when he was teaching the memorabilia part of the fall course, and in my own tutorial with him on the memorabilia, his heart was in it. Those were things he was working on and writing on, and it was very different. And even the Apology in Crito, wasn't he then writing the piece for the Klein Festschrift too? Whereas I thought in the spring, the Rousseau course, I did feel that his heart was not in it, that it was being taught more dutifully or mechanically. But it seemed to me that one saw him thinking in class, because these were things he was really working on. Those are my own reminiscences. In support of what you said about the private teaching, in the tutorial, the first 5 minutes were always not about Xenophon, but about something else, de Gaulle or the student uprisings or whatever. That for some reason, unlike the classroom, it was not proper to get down to business immediately in such circumstances, to my surprise. Jerrold Caplan received his PhD in philosophy from Catholic University, and as you will already know and will hear, his bachelor's degree from St. John's, and has now gone back to school to get a master's degree in the Eastern Classics from St. John's Santa Fe. He teaches philosophy at Moorpark College and has written on Plato and T.E. Lawrence. Professor Caplan.
I shudder to think what Mr. Strauss might have thought about the study of Eastern classics after this, but anyway, it's quite an honor for me to be here this weekend to honor Mr. Strauss and contribute what I can to some recollections about him as a teacher. I must confess that my association with him was not as long nor as intimate as many of his students from his days here in Chicago, and I presume also at Claremont. And while we never had what might be a formal student-teacher relationship, I have some sense of how the students of Mr. Strauss at Chicago felt about him, because I have that same feeling about my teacher and friend Lawrence Burns, who, besides the many other intellectual debts that I owe him, was the efficient cause of my being here today. He was very much looking forward to being here, where he would have been so much in his element, with so many of his friends and admirers among you, and I'm sure that you share my deep sense of loss at his recent passing. It's a great loss to the conference as well, not least owing to the inexhaustible wealth of stories about Mr. Strauss that Lawrence carried with him. He was my teacher at St. John's when I was a freshman in 1969, as was his wife Gisela, and I can safely say that in the 40 plus years that we've known each other and become rather close friends, there was never an occasion, either when visiting with one another or speaking on the phone, when he did not recount some story about Strauss. I take that as evidence not only of his deep affection for Mr. Strauss, but also of the profound impact that Mr. Strauss had on so many of his best students. At any rate, I know that he recommended me to Professor Tarcov, to whom I'd like to express my gratitude, as well as to the members of the board of the Strauss Center for this very kind invitation. My first encounter with Mr. Strauss came when I was a freshman at St. John's College in Annapolis, both of us arriving in the fall of 1969. I, fresh out of high school, and Mr. Strauss as scholar in residence, which, as far as I know, was a position invented for him, unprecedented. I don't think it's been done since, I gather some of his students had arranged this for him to be able to work on his the writings that he was engaged in, and in return he gave a class once a week, which I'll say something about. But because of my situation there, I'd like to offer a few reflections and an appreciation from the perspective of a naive, young, utterly inexperienced undergraduate. Soon after Mr. Strauss came to Annapolis in 69, he began to offer weekly classes held in the afternoons. And of course, I'm sure many of you are familiar with the curriculum at St. John's, but it was not part of the required curriculum, so anyone could attend. They were on topics ranging from the writings of Xenophon and Thucydides to Plato and Nietzsche. Many people came from outside the immediate St. John's community, including former students and others acquainted with his work. The classes were held in what was called the conversation room, normally used as the venue in which lecturers answered questions after the Friday night lecture. As a result, it could accommodate quite a few people, and I seem to recall that they were usually well attended. I attended those classes in all but my freshman year. Each Wednesday, at the prescribed time, Mr. Strauss came, accompanied by his assistant, then my friend Mr. Blanton. He walked with a cane, somewhat slowly, as I recall, seeming to my young eyes physically frail. However, once he took his seat and opened the text, there was no evidence of frailty or of hesitation. He was in complete command. There were no notes of any kind. His procedure was to have one of his students read a passage from the text, and then he would comment. In a recent conversation with my friend, Mr. Robert Gary, the reader for the first 2 years, I was reminded of several things from those classes. Mr. Strauss consistently displayed a kind of gentleness. He welcomed questions and, in fact, seemed to relish the ones from the toughest and least sympathetic questioner in the room. While gentle toward the inquirer, he always showed supreme confidence that whatever the question, he could respond to it, and he did so. But he would check back with the questioner to make sure that the response had been received and understood. One always had the opportunity to follow up, and Mr. Strauss was patient but firm. He had a precise neatness and tidiness in how he conducted a discussion. With so many people in the room, he could never completely control where the conversation might go next. But even so, Mr. Strauss did not leave loose ends lying about. Any earnest concern that he didn't get to directly, he tucked away, kept it in the memory stack, and when it was possible, he would come back around and pick it up and deal with it. Sometimes this had to happen after the class, but very often he made it happen while the class was still in session. No thread got dropped if he could help it. He knew where he needed to come back to, and he figured out ways to do it. This takes a very precise and tidy mind and a good memory, and I would say a lot of caring. Mr. Strauss cared deeply about making sure earnest and worthy questions got answered. In my senior year, owing to the benefaction of my teacher, Lawrence Burns, although I didn't know it at the time, I was offered as my student aide job the post of secretary and typist for Mr. Strauss. To be given the opportunity to assist him and be invited to his apartment in Eastport, just across the bridge in Annapolis, was not only a distinct honor, but an incredibly intimidating assignment, mostly owing to my increasing familiarity with the reputation of the man who had taught so many of my own teachers. Once a week, I would visit him at his home, a modest apartment a few miles from the college. He was very considerate, usually offered me a soft drink before we got underway, and we would enter his study, a small study, which was quite filled with books. But what impressed me the most at that time was not the size and extent of his library, but the variety of languages of his rather well-worn collection. Besides English, there were books in German, of course, but also in French, in Greek, in Latin, in Hebrew, perhaps other languages. But the fact there was such linguistic breadth was at once impressive and overwhelming to me at that time in my life. A vague idea began to take shape in my mind about what the demands of true scholarship were. It suggested a familiarity with, if not command of, the writings of thinkers of all ages and traditions, ancient, medieval, and modern, and an ability to read them on their own terms and in their own languages. At that early stage of my academic career, the model displayed for me was enormously inspiring and yet incredibly daunting. And even today, almost 40 years later, that model of scholarly excellence remains for me both inspiring and incredibly daunting. Mr. Strauss was very soft-spoken. He was precise and deliberate in his diction. Whether his cadence was naturally slow or whether he simply went out of his way to accommodate me, he did his best to allow me time to record his words, which I was writing out longhand. I simply don't remember whether he read from a completely composed text, although he did have yellow notepads that contained either the complete text or detailed notes. It must have been somewhat trying for him to have someone so unfamiliar with his work and with no knowledge of German at the time. I didn't even know what an umlaut was then, but Mr. Strauss instructed me when and where to place the two dots. While I began to feel less confident in my ability to be of real service to him, owing to my inexperience, he remained patient and very welcoming. It was during this time that I was able to assist him in recording and typing the drafts of two of his last articles, one on Nietzsche's Beyond Good and Evil and one on the gods in Thucydides, subsequently published in the journal Interpretation. St. John's College in Annapolis, as so many of you know, is the so-called Great Books School, and it was Mr. Strauss's final academic home. Graduates earn degrees in liberal arts, with the expectation that they've received the benefits of liberal education. One such benefit is having spent 4 years learning from the greatest minds of the Western tradition through through reading some of their greatest writings. Mr. Strauss reminds us, however, that the encounter with the thoughts of the greatest minds often requires the mediation of teachers who are themselves still students, even if the very best of students. Mr. Strauss was the embodiment of liberal education. Forever a student himself of the great teachers of the past, he was also one of the greatest teachers. He made it possible for many of us of lesser talent to join in the continuing conversation of great thoughts, of making the writings of past thinkers continue to live. He not only made it possible, but he made us want to join that conversation because, as he taught, the rewards of such education are human excellence itself. There was also implicit in his teaching the duty to cultivate what is best and highest in our natures, our intellects, which would make us better prepared to assume our place as citizens in a liberal democracy, where prudent judgment and deliberative skills are indispensable. Of great thinkers, Mr. Strauss exhorted us to encounter them through their writings, saying of them in his article on liberal education, I quote, "We're not likely to meet any of them anywhere. It's a piece of good luck if there is a single one alive in one's time." Against those odds, most of us who knew and studied with Mr. Strauss regard ourselves to have had more than a piece of good luck. In my senior year, when I began looking ahead to studies after St. John's, I asked Mr. Strauss for advice about graduate school. He proposed Catholic University in Washington, D.C., mentioning that Mr. Richard Kennington was taking up a position there, which reminds me of an interesting little story. I studied with Mr. Kennington, who many of you know was, among other things, admired for his work in Descartes. One of his students called him, I believe, the benchmark by which all Cartesian scholarship should be measured. At any rate, I took a number of classes, but one on Descartes' Meditations. I recall an afternoon when Mr. Kennington was lecturing on the Meditations, and he was about to cite something in the text, and I don't remember his exact words, but he said something like, "We have here another example of what Strauss says," and then he caught himself and said, "I mean Descartes." And I just took this as another piece of evidence of the enduring effect that Strauss had on his students, that somehow, even in the midst of a class on Descartes, Mr. Strauss was somehow present in the minds of his students. At any rate, Mr. Strauss sadly passed away not long after I graduated in 1973. I did follow his advice, albeit not right away, attended graduate school at Catholic U, and became far better acquainted with his writings as a graduate student than I ever had as an undergraduate. There was also an opportunity to read the works of several of his students, some of whom are here today, of course, and I was fortunate to study with some of them. It's mainly from them that I formulated for myself the meaning of the term Straussian, since they all exhibited some measure of the model set by their teacher. A Straussian, in my view, is someone governed by the highest standards of scholarship, whose academic interests and pursuits are not parochial, who shows by example how to read great books, by treating every word as carefully chosen and hence worthy of attention, and who defends the idea that there are such things as great books and great teachers, and that learning from them, to quote Plato's Socrates, makes us better and braver and less helpless. One must conclude from this perspective, Mr. Strauss was, to use a phrase often employed by him, the liberal artist par excellence.
Our final speaker at this panel is Theodore Blanton, who received his BA from St. John's College and his law degree from Georgetown. He served as legislative assistant to Senators Moynihan, Morgan, and Danforth before going into private practice, served as a North Carolina district judge, and now has again returned to private practice. Mr. Blanton.
Thank you.
Nathan, I'm going to take the podium. I'll be shorter.
I think you'll be taller.
I feel more comfortable standing. More like the courtroom.
I don't think I can add much to what's been said, so it's a challenge to come last and to say something relevant. But I do want to say that I remember very clearly being 22 and being informed by Leon Cass, now of the University of Chicago, that Leo Strauss did not levitate into his trousers in the morning. Cass obviously thought that my awe of Strauss as a St. John's student ought to be diminished just a bit. Most days now I can say that Cass was probably right about that, that he did not levitate. I there were many mornings I wanted to go over and see for myself whether that might not be the case. I want to say something about this room, and it just strikes me being up front. This is a much more intimate room from up front than it is out there where you are. When you're sitting at this table, really it looks like you could reach out and just about touch every student. It has a different feel from up there looking down. And it's humbling to me to be in this room and to think about what happened in this room, to think about how many lives were changed in this room and how the ripples keep moving away from this room into the world. My introduction to Mr. Strauss came when I was 19 and studying at a college close to my home in North Carolina, Wake Forest, and where I had the just wonderful good fortune of studying with David Broyles, who had been an undergraduate at Chicago and was in this room for some of Mr. Strauss's classes. And he said what I think is true, and Jerry Caplan touched on it just a moment ago, as did Richard Zinman. It takes time to realize what has happened to you. And I think that was true of David Broyles very much. He went into engineering, actually, after Chicago. But after he thought back about who Mr. Strauss was, what he was trying to teach, and what happened to him in this room, he went back, got his PhD, and went into full-time teaching, and how grateful I am for that. And it wouldn't have happened except for what happened at this table and what happened to the minds and the hearts and the souls of the young men and women who sit where you do. So I want to express my gratitude for being here. And I also want to thank Larry Burns, probably, who, as Jerry said, died recently, because I wouldn't be here had he not recommended me to Professor Tarcov. During my first year at St. John's, Mr. Strauss was teaching his Wednesday afternoon class on Nietzsche's Beyond Good and Evil. Strauss never taught in the St. John's program. I think he would have been horrified to do that. Johnny's read much, much too fast. They read too many things too fast. Tutors were expected to teach across the entire curriculum, which meant math and science and languages and laboratory, as well as great book seminars. That was not his idea of how to study or how to teach. He was very amusing to me a couple of times when he said he thought an entire undergraduate curriculum could be built around only four books, and that was such a contrast to what we were doing at St. John's. The second year I was at St. John's, I was his manservant, to quote Professor Zinman. I think that's about right. Strauss was teaching Thucydides, and I think it was that year that the essay on Thucydides he was working on it and published an interpretation. I'm not sure of the timing, but that's the way I remember it. Robert Goldwyn was the dean, a Chicago PhD in the 50s, along with many of the panelists yesterday, was the dean of St. John's College. He asked me to be Strauss's manservant. And at that time, my duties were to pick him up on Wednesday afternoon at his apartment and drive him to class. I would sit by his side and be his reader. Typically, I would read a paragraph of the Peloponnesian War. He would comment on it and take questions. Doesn't that sound so simple? And indeed, from my side, it was very simple. But grappling with Strauss and his prodigious intellect was anything but simple. By the early 70s, Mr. Strauss was, as Professor Zinman has described, very much a frail and physically tiny man, very soft-spoken, very gentle. I was impressed by Eva Braun's reference to his gentlemanliness in an interview that George Anastopoulos did with her, Eva Braun, a longtime tutor at St. John's, when she said, Strauss was absolutely the most exquisitely courteous man imaginable. I think that was particularly true when women were in the room, for myself. I think he was an old school gentleman in that sense. And I think it was a little less so when he was surrounded just by men. That's just my own take on it. His classroom manner, to me now, his appearance and classroom manner were so different than his books, the majesty of his books, the bold rhetoric in his books. You just didn't see that in class, or at least in my time, I did not. When you think about the great legacy of the Strauss students, the grand students, the great grand students, it really is astonishing. And I share Professor Gorevich's thought that one of the difficulties of the Straussians, if there is such a thing, is that they're competing camps. I think Strauss was such a modest man in so many, many ways that I think he'd be a bit mystified by that, by the intensity of the struggles over his legacy. Perhaps you don't agree with that. The other thing that reminds me to say is that on the after the pleasure of hearing the very learned panelists yesterday, and having known their name, having seen them before, some of them before, and certainly having heard their names for 50 years, well, in my case, probably 40 years, I suggested that this panel be canceled and that the panel from yesterday be restored, and like Bacon's recommendation for torturing nature, that we torture them for another 2 or 3 hours, because I think that we would have really gotten a lot of a lot of wisdom out of such a torture. I hope I'll have a chance sometime. As Jerry Caplan said, Mr. Strauss's life did appear blissfully simple, just from the observer standpoint. Except for eating his meals, relaxing with Mrs. Strauss, and occasionally seeing a friend, he studied and he wrote. His library, to me, looked like it had been pared down to about 250 books. Maybe it was a little larger than that, but not substantially. His study that Jerry Caplan refers to was his bedroom. Imagine, if you will, a small, nondescript garden apartment where you had to go down the steps to the apartment, and the apartment opened onto the lawn of the apartment complex behind it. The bedroom had a single bed, a straight back desk chair, an upholstered armchair, I think, as I remember it, and a few bookshelves. That was it. Mrs. Strauss had a separate bedroom. There were only three other rooms, a bath, a small kitchen, and a living room containing a small dining area. And as far as I know, Mr. Strauss never took any exercise other than a very short walk out the doors of the apartment. And as he got more ill, that was impossible. Mr. Strauss certainly stringently avoided the demands of things. He imitated Socrates in that way. Gentlemen, to paraphrase Aristotle, definitely require equipment, property, and a certain amount of wealth, but managing or acquiring them takes effort away from the pursuit of higher things, and Strauss was with Socrates in keeping his focus on the higher things. The Strausses didn't do any shopping in the normal sense of the word. They didn't go to the mall, they didn't go downtown. Groceries were ordered from a little gourmet grocer in Annapolis with the wonderful name of Rookies. And Mr. Strauss thought that he was getting rooked every time the bill came in. It was a constant memory of mine that is we had to drive past rookies to get to the college on the way to his Wednesday afternoon class, and he would always comment on the rookies and give that laugh like he knew that they were swindlers of the highest order. I also learned to use a wonderful word which we Southerners would probably use for something like low-down, no-count ruffian. His word was gutter snipe. Try using gutter snipe sometime soon in your conversation. I assure you that it will get a marvelous reaction. I do remember that it was used in by Henry Higgins in My Fair Lady. And maybe that was the source for Strauss's love of the word. I don't know. Once I did take him shopping for a new pair of trousers, which was obviously an act of desperation on his part, and I remember the salesman at the men's shop in Annapolis called Johnson's on the Avenue trying to encourage him to buy a fairly loud plaid trouser. And Strauss was very modest, very quiet. He solemnly told the salesman that he preferred his trousers like his dogs, just in solid colors, please. And he did love dogs, as I think Professor Faulkner commented on yesterday. At that time, he was especially in love with Jenny's large, rambunctious, old English sheepdog, whose name was Hopox, if I remember correctly. And as Professor Faulkner said, he did have the sense not to own a pet because it would be too much work. The other thing that I very distinctly remember is that within the Strauss family as a whole, the great quip at the time about Strauss was that his favorite cologne was Essence de Chien Moué, or in plain English, fragrance of wet dog. The only timepiece I ever saw Strauss with was an inexpensive wind-up Westclocks pocket watch. He sent me out to buy a new one once when his old one conked out, and he kept it on his writing desk in his bedroom in the little cardboard box that it came in. And he would, I don't know when he would take it out and put it back, but the little cardboard box remained there for all the time that I was there. His, as has been commented, he was, I think someone used the word impishness. That's true. Certainly his size would lend to that description, but mischievous is the word that seems most appropriate to me. Quite mischievous, a man, and his joke delivery always put me in mind of Jack Benny. Some of you are old enough to remember Jack Benny. When we would pull up to the college, to the parking lot, to where he got out and went into the classroom, he would, more than once he said to me, "Keep the engine running, I'll be right back with the money." Now, there are at least two interpretations of that. The first interpretation is that, you know, he was pretending that we were bank robbers on the case. The other interpretation, maybe the more serious one, that it was a comment on the teaching profession. And when I took Mr. Strauss home after those Wednesday afternoon classes, he would usually say to me, after I thanked him, as I always did, for both the class and for being able to talk to him in the car on the way there and back, he would often say, "I am glad to have been of service." Now, it took me a while to figure out that that was the response that Jeeves, as has been mentioned, that famous English valet and gentleman's gentleman, that was how he would respond to Bertie. Bertie was, as you know, his half-wit employer. So that, you know, his "I'm glad to have been of service" certainly took on a meaning for me as to his as to his judgment on my intellect, and I have to say that I think his judgment was about right. Strauss told a wonderful story about his dear friend and old friend and fellow philosopher, I think I could say, Jacob Klein, then at St. John's. And I hasten to say, as probably all of you know, Mr. Strauss would never refer to himself as a philosopher. And I think that was true certainly in public, and I think it was certainly true in in private and in his books. I don't think he would ever, although we take it for granted that he was a philosopher, I'm not sure that he did take it. I'm not sure he considered it that way. But at any rate, back to Klein. He says about Klein that when they were students of philosophy in their 20s, that they would go with some other fellow students to a coffee shop in Berlin near the Prussian State Library where they were studying, and that that Klein hated to be singled out. He hated notoriety, and particularly he didn't want to be known as an intellectual. So Strauss said that Klein cultivated the air of the idle businessman when they were ever in public out at a coffee shop, and Strauss, for his own amusement and to get a rise out of Klein, would yell out at the top of his voice, "Nietzsche!" or something like that, just to see him squirm. I thought that was a wonderful story. Another story that I always loved, this I didn't see it, but I've heard it many times, so it must be true, that Mr. Strauss went into a bookstore either in New York or Chicago asking for a particular Platonic text in Greek, and after being told that the bookstore did not have the volume, he turned to the clerk and said, "What? Are we in darkest Africa?" Now, finally, let me close with an account of Mr. Strauss's death, because I was there for part of that scene. During the period that he was in Annapolis, he was in failing health. He always walked with a cane. He was physically weak, often winded after a few steps. He never commented, in my hearing, on the condition of his body or his health generally. And as far as I could tell, he was a complete stoic on the matter of physical health and bearing up under what difficulties it brought. The day before he died, he was committed to lecture at Haverford College, where his daughter Jenny was on the faculty, and I've often thought to myself many times since then that as much as he wanted to deliver that lecture, he wanted to see Jenny and was determined to go. He was in no shape to go, no shape whatsoever. He could barely walk. But he insisted on going. His doctor told him, and his doctor in Annapolis said, "Don't go. You're in no shape to go." He literally could not walk two steps on his own power. But he insisted that he was going to Haverford to deliver the lecture. And I was the driver. Mrs. Strauss and I helped him out to the car, to the front seat of the car. He couldn't get there on his own. He reclined in the seat on the way to Haverford. I remember that. He didn't talk much. Mrs. Strauss didn't like the whole decision to go, but she was resigned to it because she had to be. He couldn't get up to the car from the front steps, from the front door of his apartment. I had to drive the car up on the lawn right up to the back door in order to get him out the four or five steps it would take to get to the front seat. Well, when we got to Haverford, it didn't take Jenny long before she knew that he was very seriously ill and wanted to take him directly to the hospital. He finally agreed that he was not able to deliver the lecture, but he insisted, absolutely insisted on going home to Annapolis. So we turned around and drove straight back. We went directly to the emergency room at the hospital in Annapolis. I took Mrs. Strauss home. She was just emotionally exhausted by that point. And I went back to the hospital. For what seemed much too long a time, Mr. Strauss and I were alone in the emergency room. He was on a gurney. Doctors were coming and going. They were, you know, he was not the most serious case in the emergency room, since he was not bleeding. He was just slowly dying. I was beside myself trying to make sure he got the appropriate attention, but I don't think I had much effect. But I do remember a couple of things about that scene. He never complained. He did not talk about any pain he felt. I got the distinct impression that he did not want to be left alone, that he wanted a friend with him. I was that friend for a couple of hours. I held his hand for periods of time. We looked at one another. Not much was said, really. as the doctors and nurses came and went. I don't remember whether I left the hospital and went to pick up Mrs. Strauss and return her to the hospital or not, but I do remember leaving the hospital for a couple of hours after he was admitted to a private room. And when I got back there, Mrs. Strauss was there, Mr. Klein was there, and Lawrence Burns was there in the room. And there was that part of me, remember now, I'm a 22-year-old student, and I want to know, what is this great man going to say if he's at death's door to his wife, to his oldest friend, and to one of his most devoted students? I will admit that my curiosity was getting the better of me, even though I was at the age where I still felt immortal. But my own sense of modesty overcame that, and I left. And as best I recall, Mr. Strauss died about a day later, late on the next afternoon. Mr. Strauss was, of course, a Jew, which reminds me to say, I was saying to Abe Shulsky yesterday how the timing of this conference on the holiest weekend of Christianity, that it was so funny to me that it was scheduled on the Easter weekend. And he said, oh, I don't feel discriminated against. This is Passover as well. You know, it's one of those rare times when Easter and Passover come together at the same time in the calendar. So apparently Jews and Christians are insulted by being here. And I haven't brought that up with Mr. Tarcov, but I'm sure he has a good excuse for that. Mr. Strauss was, of course, a Jew, and by his own account, a Zionist as a young man. Absent that Jewishness, he may have lived out his life in Germany, and those of us in the United States would have been much the poorer. Obviously, his chance towards Judaism changed, and I'm reminded of that comment Winston Churchill made when asked about his relation to the Anglican Church. Churchill said he was not a pillar of the church, but rather a flying buttress. That is to say, standing on the outside holding it up. I think that probably describes Mr. Strauss's relationship to Orthodox Judaism. And yet, I give you this caution. When Eva Braun in 07 was being interviewed by George Anasopoulos about Strauss and Klein at St. John's, she quotes fairly extensively from Klein about conversations that Strauss and Klein had in the early 70s. And Klein says that Mr. Strauss expressed to him more and more the sense that tradition and reverence were of very great importance in his life, and that he was more conscious of his Judaism than he had been, which is hard to imagine, than he had been. Klein even suggested that Strauss was turning again in the direction of Orthodoxy. Now, I have to say, I didn't see any evidence, either with my own ears or my own eyes, that Strauss was turning back in the direction of Orthodoxy. I did not. But the fact that I know he and Klein had a number of serious discussions just the two of them, and Klein's remarks give me enormous pause about concluding what I think I know about Leo Strauss and Judaism, about what the conclusion should be. Now, I really am finished. Strauss in the classroom. Unlike his accusers, Strauss did not teach any doctrines in the classroom as far as I could see. He just didn't. Whenever he clarified or commented on a text, he always asked his class, does that make sense? What do you think? He always expected a dialogue. He always thought of himself as a student, an advanced student, of course, but a student, not someone who had all of the answers, but simply appreciated some of the important questions. My observation of him in the 70s, when I was quite a young man, was that the high regard that he was then held in, or shall we even use the word reverence, the reverence that he was held in by so many worked against him as a teacher, that it discouraged the kind of dialogue that he wanted, and I suspect had much more spirited dialogue in his classes here at Chicago than at St. John's. I remember in particular a group of New School graduate students coming down from New York for a private seminar with Mr. Strauss. I think it was on Thucydides, but I can't be sure. I can't remember that well. But I do remember this. They were, the grad students sat at the table and they were dumbstruck. It was almost as though they couldn't speak. They were in the presence of Leo Strauss. And Strauss wanted to talk. He wanted them to ask questions and he wanted to have a dialogue with them. And I think in desperation, he turned to me. Now, I'm his reader seated at his right shoulder. And he said, you were saying in the car, thus and so. So I knew it was an act of desperation. And I think he assumed that example would loosen up the tongues of the New School graduate students. It did not. It was a very awkward experience. And, I think that what they wanted him to do was to deliver a learned lecture. I think they wanted him to be the Delphic oracle, if you will. And he steadfastly refused to do that. Now, let me say that I concluded my paper with, or remarks with, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 pages of things I think I learned from Strauss, and you're going to be spared all of those.
I'd like to reassure Judge Blanton and the rest of you that you will have a chance to torture the first panel, because at the end of the next panel, we will, after a break of just a few minutes for rearrangements up front, bring all the panelists forward, and you will have a chance to torture them, and they can torture each other. Two other recollections were brought back to me, one actually by Mr. Caplan's remarks about Mr. Strauss suggesting that he pursue his graduate studies at Catholic University. It reminds me that when Mr. Strauss told me that he would be leaving Claremont, which I think he had not yet made public at that time, he encouraged me to pursue my graduate studies at Harvard. With Harvey Mansfield, obviously he didn't think I was fit for philosophy, and agreed to write a letter of recommendation to make that possible. Unless I just want to repeat something very important that Richard Zinman brought back to me, which was, unlike him, I had not had no access to the transcripts and had not read Strauss's books very seriously prior to my year at Claremont. But was reading them with great intensity that year, very much assisted by Victor Gurevich's articles. Where's Victor? There he is, hiding over there. And that I did have the opportunity to talk with Mr. Strauss about them, and he spoke very highly and appreciatively of actually, it's probably in between the first article and the second, to be very precise. And he spoke very appreciatively of that first article. Do any of the other panelists wish to add or subtract anything to what's been said? If not, the floor is open to questions. Please, we have mics again. Please use the mic, speak up, briefly identify yourself and indicate, and be brief in your question or observation, and if it is directed to a particular panelist, please make that clear. Mr. Brody?
I don't need the mic.
You don't need the mic. No, you need it to be recorded.
It's got to be recorded.
Just a quick question to Professor Zinman about the Chicago sit-in, which was certainly tumultuous and more prolonged than any of the others that you mentioned and that Strauss had commented upon. Just curious if he had had occasion to pass upon that.
I don't remember him commenting. When was that precisely?
68, spring of 68.
No, I just don't remember. I had lots of notes from that time, but they were all destroyed in a fire when a warehouse burned down. So I would say I'm about 85% certain that about 85% of what I said is true.
I don't remember him ever commenting on that at when that time at Claremont.
Me neither. If it was 68, I wouldn't have been there. Yes, Mr. House. Mike.
Rob House, New York University. So first of all, I think that the achievement of the project of, or partial achievement of the project, which is the context for this conference, is something to be enormously celebrated. And so I'd like to congratulate the Strauss Center and particularly Nathan and Stephen for having already managed to bring it this far. And I think it's especially important because it has the potential to clarify, if not entirely refute, because of course one could never be sure what Strauss might have said otherwise in private, certain very wide misconceptions about the purpose and character of his his teaching. But I have a kind of general question. I never knew Strauss. I discovered his writing, unfortunately, just around the time he was dying, when I was a high school student trying to understand Maimonides. And I've been reading and rereading his works ever since. I think I understand them a bit better now, I guess 40 years later. But I wonder, since I've listened to a number of the transcripts, I read some of the transcripts and listened to quite a few of the tapes that are now on the internet. And I wonder, those of you who studied with Strauss and took the classes, do you think there's anything of philosophical importance that Strauss taught in the classes or privately that could not be learned from a careful and rigorous study of his published writings? Is there anything that you could think of? And secondly, and this is connected to what Mr. Blanton said that I found extremely interesting, about Strauss's relation to Judaism and the way he was articulating it late in his life. I think if you were also to read some of his late correspondence with Gershom Scholem, you would perhaps find hints also of, at least if not a reevaluation, a rearticulation of his connection to Judaism, and a suggestion that even if he was not an atheist but an Unglauber, that that nevertheless, if he never quite could believe in God, he never ceased to try and understand him.
That is addressed to all of you, or any of you. Mr. Zinman?
My first inclination is to say about the question of, is there anything of philosophic interest in the courses that is not accessible in the books? My first inclination would be to say no. But I would qualify that in a couple of ways. First of all, despite my love for Nathan, despite my love for Steve, I have some doubts about this project. Even though I'm participating.
Turn off the video. No.
I think there is a danger that I think there is a danger that too much attention will end up being paid to his courses and not as much attention to his books. As I said in my remarks, I think there is a fairly big difference between his courses and his books. But I would make one obvious exception, and I remember the impact of this exception, and that is his course on the symposium. His course on the symposium was simply, I think it was the best course he ever taught. It also seemed to be prepared and presented at a level that just transcended the level of almost any other course I can think of. There are other courses that are almost up there. But I think our understanding of his understanding of Plato, and therefore his teaching about Plato, would be diminished if we didn't have that course. Now, of course, we have that course published as a book edited by Seth Benedetti. I haven't read every transcript. But another transcript that comes to mind, I don't think the course is nearly at that level, but I do think a course he taught on Nietzsche's Zarathustra teaches us some things about Strauss's understanding of Nietzsche and perhaps about Nietzsche that are not accessible from the one article he wrote about Nietzsche, which is a very pregnant article. I also think that the other thing that would be lost is whether you consider this philosophic relevance or not, I think is debatable, but what would be lost would be the example of Strauss teaching. And that example, I think, was a very powerful one, despite the fact that there was, let's make this comparison, there was a difference between Strauss as teacher and Strauss as thinker. It's not that you didn't see Strauss thinking in the classroom, but you didn't see Strauss philosophizing at the highest level he was capable of in the classroom. Whereas, say, in Heidegger's courses, there was a much, much closer relationship between what Heidegger was doing in his classes and what he was thinking about. I think that was intentional on Strauss's part. But still, the model of teaching with this kind of, I don't want to repeat what everyone has said today and yesterday, with this kind of simplicity, directness, concreteness, I think that's philosophically relevant. So in that sense, I approve.
Thank you, Dick, for that vote of confidence. I have not listened to all the audio files. I just put them online. It's like the old Jewish joke of, Sam sells the truckload of locks to Abe, who sells them to Shlomo, who sells them to Irv, and then Irv finally decides to taste them, and they're just inedible, and comes back, and these are not eating, these are buying and selling locks. These are just, I just put them on the internet. I don't taste them first. But I take that back. I agree with the latter, the second half of what Dick said. Of course, I think in the sort of hierarchy of Strauss's legacy, his published writings enjoy obvious preeminence. But the private correspondence, only a part of which has so far been published in Heinrich Meyer's Gesammelte Schriften and earlier in some other places too, is very interesting philosophically, in some ways is more candid than the published writings, but always, of course, involves some ad hominem questions of whom they're addressed to and what the prior correspondence and perhaps private conversations were with the recipient. There are lectures that he wrote out more or less as carefully as his published writings, some of which have been published, two of them in Heinrich Meyer's Theological Political Problem, some elsewhere. There are lectures he delivered that were taped and transcribed, which are obviously more prepared than his classes, and some of them written out, but others sound as if they were from notes, have a somewhat lower status. And then the classes, are transcripts and tapes are as guides to his thought, would probably come in, I've lost track of how I'm counting, fourth or so,
in that, but they do have decided advantages. You get to see him answering questions, some of which maybe you would have liked to ask, and you can't do that with the books. And there's also just, you know, there's not only the symposium, the Protagoras, the Gorgias, which he was writing about at the very time of his death. So there are important Platonic dialogues which he did not write about, but did teach, the Meno, which he, a class which he prepared very carefully, as his notes indicate. There are the three classes on Nietzsche, which I think will be quite important. And then there are odd things here and there. In the Cicero course, he devotes one session to chapter one of Beta of the Physics and a chapter from Theta of the Metaphysics on what is nature. He doesn't do that in his published writings. And I think he does that again in some other class. I'm not sure which it is. I think there are things that, although they're sort of authoritative status as a guide to his thought, and their precision is much below the published writings, address subjects of great philosophical importance, either in, at least in ways that his published writings don't.
May I respond?
Please.
Not about the transcripts, because I've only seen a few of them, but I think like any man or any woman, Mr. Strauss could be much more direct and blunt in private conversation. That's why I think a number of the older students need to be tortured more, because I suspect that they spent hours and hours with him that those of us who saw him as a much older man didn't have. Because he wasn't as strong. But I can say for myself that having been in conversation with him or having watched conversations that he was in, he could be much more direct and would probably say things that he would never think of saying in public.
Mr. Gilman?
There were times when he spoke of writing a sequel to natural right and history, taking it into the 19th century, and dealing with Kant, and dealing with Hegel, and dealing with Nietzsche more fully than he had in any of his published writings. And unfortunately, he did not live to carry this project out, so the transcripts are what we have regarding that.
Mr. Lynch?
Thanks. Chris Lynch, Carthage College. This isn't meant to disrupt that hierarchy that Nathan just established. It seems about right to me. But I'm wondering about a very practical question about how there might be a place where there might be a link between what goes on in the class and what goes on in the published works, and that is the nature of the preparation that I've heard many people talk about that he did for the classes. But I also heard Robert Faulkner say that he didn't use notes in class. How did he transfer, I mean, what was the nature, really practically speaking, of the preparation that he would do for the seminars, and how would he then deploy that in class? And how, if at all, would he then go from what he did in class to take whatever thoughts that he may have advanced in class back into his own scholarship, if at all, or do we know anything about that? I guess I'd ask it of either any generation of students of Strauss.
Hey.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, his typical class was there'd usually be a student paper in which the student would read the paper at the beginning, and Strauss would comment about it, often not very much. And then, you know, you'd go into the text, and the reader would read a paragraph and so forth. I think on those, I really just don't remember him having notes or using notes. I mean, it was a text he was studying, so he knew it very well, and he knew, of course, he must have marked out ahead of time, I think, what paragraphs he wanted the reader to read. So he knew what he thought was most important. But that was stuff that was, you know, he was thinking at the time, in a sense. And I mean, there would be occasions when he'd come in. Sometimes it was to answer a question that he felt he hadn't dealt with sufficiently the previous class, with a little, you know, so to speak, set piece. In other words, he would have a, well, in his typical way, it would be a piece of paper this big, writing microscopic, you know, that somehow he was able to read. So there would be occasional sort of set pieces where he's clearly, he had written out what he wanted to say. But the bulk of most of the classes was, after all, you know, an ongoing reading of a text. So my impression was that he came in pretty much only with a list of which passages he wanted the reader to read and then the class to discuss.
I think there were some exceptions. Rare, but I could think of two. First of all, Strauss gave repeated versions of the same course quite often. I'm sorry, he taught Aristotle's Politics, I don't know how many times, as a kind of
four that we have transcripts.
And then there was, and then there's the transcript of the course on Aristotle that I'm editing, and then I think Catherine,
Chris, everybody has a politics here.
And this is the basic principles course. Now, that course, the version that I'm editing, and maybe this is more appropriate to talk about this afternoon, but it's directly relevant to this question. There, he is clearly reading from or making use of a manuscript that is going to become the lectures that became The City and Man. Now, not the whole course, but a big chunk of the course. And there you can see, if you just compare what he says in the transcript to the text, that it's almost the final version in some places. Similarly, as I said, my impression from talking to him was that when he gave the class at Claremont on Plato's Apology and Crito and the memorabilia, there were portions of the memorabilia that he taught, and he was, I don't know whether he was speaking from notes or not. I mean, usually I think, at least when I saw him, he did have something in front of him. It wasn't just speaking off the top of his head. They're minimal notes. But in this case, if you compare the passages about what he says about this portion of the memorabilia with what he says about the same thing in the book Xenophon Socrates, he's already beginning to write about Xenophon Socrates. So I think there are some differences, although they're rare, because I would you say, what about, for example, when he was working on Thoughts on Machiavelli? He gave a class on Machiavelli. We don't have the transcript. What about City and Man I just mentioned? Well, what about Socrates and Aristophanes?
There's a class where he taught some of it.
But it would be interesting to see whether his presentation of the interpretation of the plays in class is basically the same as the interpretation that appears in print.
Well, one of the assignments I gave to you and the other editors of the transcripts is to compare what he says in the transcript to what he says in the published works. Don't forget to do that in your introduction.
One last point, responding to something that was said earlier. When it was, as you said, it was quite something to have Strauss say, well, now I'm going to dictate a book to you. at least in the case of the dictation he did to me, he was clearly reading from a notebook in which every word was written out. Now, it's true, and I hate to mention this for those who are numerologists and counters, I'll tell this story, but you can't be certain whether Professor Strauss was telling the truth or not. But at the end of the, after we finished transcribing the Economicus book, and it was all typed up, and he said,
turns to me with a big smile on his face. Now, he says, Mr. Zinman, we're going to see who wins. I said, what? He said, we're going to do the index and see who I quote the most, or I refer to the most. And I was flabbergasted because I assumed he must know. I mean, isn't the book carefully written so that every mention is... Now, of course, it's possible he was just joking. And it's also possible that he wrote different books in different ways. But I was utterly flabbergasted when he said that to me.
Same question as Professor Tarkov. Who did win?
Mm-hmm. Who did he quote most?
I don't know who won.
You made that index? Mm-hmm. Can
yes,
I should admit also that the archive, which again has nothing to do with the Strauss Center, the archive is physically located in special collections at Regenstein and run and administered by them. The archive is quite incomplete for reasons unknown to me. Mr. Strauss did not keep everything. That we don't have the manuscripts of all his books. We certainly don't have first drafts, if some of the things we have are second drafts. We don't, we in some cases have a lot of notes. And for some courses there are notes, for other courses there are no notes. One project that the Strauss Center took first steps toward and then got distracted from, we did make a survey of which courses there appear to be notes from. And perhaps we will do the second step, which would be to tell all the, to give the transcript editors who are editing transcripts for which notes did survive copies of those notes, which would complicate their task. But to some extent, I regard that as a separate project to be done, not by the Strauss Center, but by individual scholars who may work in the archive and compare transcripts, notes, published work, and trace the, development or process by which he arrived at his formulations on various text. There's plenty of work to be done for several more generations, I believe.
Can I just add thing to Mr. Lynch's question? If I'm not mistaken, my memory's not perfect on this, but when Mr. Strauss came, the first two classes he gave, I think, were on Xenophon, and he had just published his book on Xenophon at Claremont, and then on the laws, which had been published. But the two things I helped him with, preliminary observation on the gods and Thucydides, probably came out of the class he did, as well as a note on the plan of Nietzsche's Beyond Good and Evil. So I suspect the class he gave in Annapolis was of a slightly different order than a normal graduate class because of the audience, and it wasn't sort of continuous. And so I suspect he was trying out some things, in preparation for working out those articles.
I think that's right, too. Yeah.
Mr. Major?
Yeah, Rafe Major. I'm wondering if you could say a little more on the status of political philosophy, which is to say, yesterday Mr. Gurvitz said he's sort of disappointed that he didn't do philosophy proper. Mr. Shulsky said it was maybe it's an accident he was in a political science department. And then Dick sort of speculated on what his career would have been like if he was able to do philosophy instead of political science. But I just wonder if that, so I see the logic of it in a certain way, but then why at the end of his life would he spend time on Xenophon, for example? I mean, is there something about political science that was a purposeful choice on his part as a beginning point, or a real way of thinking through things that quote unquote philosophy proper would not be?
I think that's quite correct. I mean, I just raised that question about whether he wound up in a political science department by chance or by design. I don't know the answer to that. But I think that his goal was in the broadest sense, it seems to me, to sort of recreate the possibility of philosophizing. And that he saw political philosophy as the sort of natural or normal entry into that. So that I don't think that was at all by accident. I mean that the problem was, in a sense, that when you looked at it in a kind of, you know, what the opposite of political philosophy is, a non-political philosophic way, you were sort of in this dead end of historicism that told you that both you couldn't know anything, but you could know that you couldn't know anything, and you sort of were faced with the problems that we mentioned, that Dick mentioned, about the real context of his work, which was the sort of self-destruction of Western, philosophic rationality. So the real question was, how do you provide the possibility of recreating that? And I think political philosophy was, for him, the obvious way to begin. I mean, it was the Socratic turn, you know, being revived in a certain sense. So in that sense, it's by no means accidental. Now, whether that could have happened, he could have done that work in a philosophy department. I mean, it would have been rather out of place in most American academic philosophy departments, but it was out of place in most American academic political science departments too. Maybe political science, because, you know, it, as a profession, it's got less coherence to it, at least certainly now, was in a way more inviting. I mean, it was more like Athenian democracy in that sense. You could, you know, I mean, if you go to a political science association convention now, you can find a paper on absolutely anything. I'm sure there's stuff on comic books. There's stuff on anything. Well, that's got its good side.
Some of which are written by Strauss.
Yeah. That's got its good side, yeah.
I mean, my sense is that when Strauss came to maturity, probably Heinrich could give you the exact date. But when he came to maturity, his coming to maturity involved something like the discovery that political philosophy, as he said, was the core of philosophy, or as I think Seth Benedetti once said, the eccentric core of philosophy. So one of the first things that Strauss wrote after I think he came to maturity was an article on Xenophon, The Spirit of Sparta and the Taste of Xenophon. Now, it's interesting that he chose never to republish that, even though I know he considered adding it to studies on Platonic political philosophy. So in a certain way, it's not that just that he sort of ended with Xenophon, he started with Xenophon. But political philosophy is the eccentric core of philosophy. And obviously, Strauss's understanding of political philosophy was, by ordinary standards, quite eccentric. And if you just look at, say, the canon as opposed to the Straussian canon, I mean, think about what Strauss added to the canon. I mean, not just Xenophon or, say, Lucretius, but Farabi, Maimonides. Think about also what was added to his canon, Lessing. I mean, now these are things that would never be taught in a political science department. Now the interesting thing is, he didn't teach those things except for Xenophon. But so I think that part of the question involves, well, what exactly is political philosophy? And then, of course, well, what exactly is philosophy? And I think he was occupied with those questions all his life.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, whether it was by chance or design that he came to a political science department opens the larger philosophical question of whether everything is by chance or design. But without attempting to resolve that on the spot, it doesn't mean, I cannot imagine he wouldn't have been Leo Strauss if political philosophy was not the central concept in his thought, whatever academic department he was in. And this is certainly clear by the late 1930s. It is political philosophy, as we know from the essay on classical political philosophy and elsewhere, it is political philosophy for which the philosophic life is the highest theme, and that his question
which in some sense is the first question of philosophy, of why philosophy, he says, is a political question. He practically uses the phrase political philosophy as a alias for himself or his approach. I mean, that essay, what philosophy as rigorous science and political philosophy, means Husserl, Heidegger, and me, right? or the studies in Platonic political philosophy. The title of the book is as clear an announcement as there can possibly be. What I do is Platonic political philosophy. So I think in that sense it was, if it was by chance, it was a happy accident.
Husserl, Heidegger, and Strauss, the true Marx brothers.
Mr. Warner?
A host of related questions. How did Strauss choose the courses that he was to teach? Why didn't he teach certain courses, certain dialogues, for example, the Theaetetus, the Sophist, Timaeus? Is it related to what Nathan has just said? I also wonder what time in the day he typically taught, and when he prepared for the courses he taught. Did he prepare the day of the course, and the course was the culmination of the day? Did he prepare the evening before or 2 days before, and he remembered what he was going to say? And finally, was there a difference in tone and temper between the courses he taught and the tutorials that he gave? Finally, did anyone ever ask him to teach a course? So these are all practical questions on the where's and the how's of all
of
these matters.
Some of which probably would be better asked to at the final hour, when we have the first generation of students present. But Mr. Faulkner had his hand up to answer a question, to ask a question, but perhaps he can shed some light on Mr. Warner's before asking his own.
My question is for Mr. Blanton. I cannot answer that question. But it's also an excuse to make a comment. The question is, which four books? Which four books did you mention that he mentioned?
Well, truthfully, he only named three.
and the unknown.
And I guess I've heard speculations on what the fourth would be. One wit said, all the others would be the fourth. But the three were the Nicomachean Ethics, Aquinas' Treatise on Law, and Kant's Groundwork of the Metaphysics of Morals. Those were the three. And he said, and he put it in exactly the context, as I remember it, that I stated. In other words, that an appropriate undergraduate curriculum could be built and should be built around those books. And of course, when you think about it, it opens doors in every direction.
So it's interesting how ethical, more ethical than political the choice is. The Aquinas is different.
My comment bears on this. That is, that what Strauss found was the need to get to the roots of the case for philosophy. And that meant returning to its beginnings. That meant, in a way, returning to what is obvious to us. And that was, as Abe said, our opinions, but our most important opinions are about what's good. And therefore, returning to that was necessary, and that's shown in the choice of the three books you just mentioned. But it's also the case that given many problems, we can never let go of that beginning. That doesn't mean we don't rise above it, but it also may mean that we're dependent upon a certain trust, in a sense, to start with. That was a word, actually, he would use upon occasion.
Mr. Hansen?
I'm Peter Hansen. A question for Dick Zinman. You mentioned at the end of the Thucydides essay, the city understands itself as subservient to the divine. Mm-hmm. And we live in a regime which largely, or for the most part, does not consciously understand itself as subservient to the divine. Does that, you think?
Au contraire. Mm-hmm. Au contraire. Au contraire. I mean, that's obviously not true, if you don't mind my speaking so directly. Well, the Declaration. Where do those rights come from? Nature and nature's God. I mean, that's a view of the divine on which the United States is established, and everything flows from that.
The judge said?
Settled.
Well, let me try again then and say the increase, what seems to be the contemporary and already by Strauss's time, of course, the self-understanding of the regime has moved away from that. Does that end up constituting a kind of, does liberalism, at least in its modern manifestation, end up constituting a kind of cave beneath the cave for Strauss?
Well, I think that, to put it crudely, even if my colleague is correct, and I think the nation is and always has been, at least in part, in disagreement about at least the extent to which it is constituted by and lives its life in the light of the divine. But I think you could say, I believe this, I don't want to put words in Strauss's mouth, but I think that in some ways, the reduction in the power of the divine in our lives, I'm not saying its absence, but the reduction of its power, especially the movement from an understanding of the divine as manifesting itself above all in divine law, which is relatively comprehensive, to an understanding of the divine as manifesting itself much more for most people in terms of certain articles of faith or dogmas which are fundamentally personal and not understanding one's whole life to be somehow regulated by divine law. Those changes, the second one, which is the result of Protestants, the victory of Protestantism, and you might say the infection of Catholicism by Protestantism, I think Strauss would say that in some ways, while that change, of course, makes it much easier to philosophize in one sense, freedom of religion means freedom of philosophizing, in another sense, it makes it much harder to begin to philosophize. And I think that one aspect of Strauss's work, a very important aspect of his work, was to recover, as you said, try to move us from the cave beneath the cave to the natural cave. But that meant recovering what it meant to live in a world for most people, that world is constituted and regulated by divine law. I mean, why does Strauss take the Bible so seriously? You might say because of his youth and his experience of his youth, and he was raised in an Orthodox Jewish home, although not a learned Orthodox Jewish home. But I think the answer is fairly obvious if you read the chapter on the origins of natural right in Natural Right and History. Why does he write a book on all of Aristophanes' plays? I mean, that's really a kind of odd thing to have done. But I think he understands that Aristophanes' plays take place within a different form of that horizon. So I think you could say, young man, if you really want to make it easier to philosophize, move to Iran.
I could say a word about that. I think one of the key motives of of Strauss's thought and philosophizing was his, I mean, and if you go back to his earliest work from the end of the 20s, beginning of the 30s, was the sort of understanding or realization that the early modern thinkers, the people, the Hobbes, Locke, Descartes, the people who thought that they had somehow or give the impression somehow that as modern scientific thinkers, they have refuted the claims of revealed religion, that those people are wrong, that they haven't done it. The understanding, I think, his final understanding, I'm not entirely clear on this, but my general impression is that essentially he believed that the early modern thinkers, rather than really refuting religion or refuting the claims of revelation, really had a kind of strategy of leaving people just to sort of forget about them. I mean, distract them, you know, give them enough iPods and other technological gizmos, give them enough medicine, good medicine that'll preserve their lives and so forth and so on, plus a kind of political system that seems to produce these good benefits. If you give people enough of this, you can sort of create a world in which people will, although you haven't really refuted the claims of revelation, people will kind of forget about them because they'll be sufficiently absorbed in the, you know, in the life that you've, artificial life in the sense that you've created for them. And that was ultimately the real problem of, you know, of modernity, was that it was a sort of forgetting of basic questions, deliberate attempt to lead people to a forgetting of them. But as it played itself out, it wound it up with people, you know, ultimately it winds up with someone like Heidegger, who strangely enough announces in that posthumous interview that only a god can save us. In other words, that the sort of modern rationalism kind of destroys itself eventually, having cut itself off from the basis of real rationalism by trying to get people to forget these real issues. So in that sense, yeah, if you want to philosophize, move to Iran. It'll be extremely difficult. You'll probably get yourself killed in the process, but the necessity of it will never be very far from your mind. I mean, you won't be tempted to sort of forget about it. Now, Strauss, I think, you know, a lot of what he was trying to understand in something like the Aristophanes book is sort of what is the sort of natural beginning point? I mean, what is the, I mean, it's a different sense of what the gods are than, of course, the revealed religions. But it has some sense, and he would talk about how there's a kind of natural reverence that people have.
I think the sense of the divine out in the hinterlands, if you will, away from the ivory tower of the academy, is much more immediate. And I think there's a connection, too, between the freedom that we all blessedly take for granted in the United States of America and the inquiry about the divine, because you have the freedom to ask yourself the question, how should I live? Which is not the case in many, many parts of the world. You are told how you must live. And because we're free to ask, how should we live? I think that question of the divine and its role in our political life lives on.
And if we look at Strauss's deeds, it is possible to read the plays of Aristophanes or read Genesis rather than move to Iran. the final question for this session, Mr. Dean.
Yes, my name is Jeff Dean. I'm an alum of the college from the 80s, so that makes me, Judge, I guess, a grand student.
I, too, am a grand student, by the way.
What struck me, I think it was Richard Zinman's comments about the time it takes to appreciate the effect a teacher can have on you, and to the extent that it's transformative or not. But it does take a while for the stuff to sort of sink in. And yet in the Claremont group's case, by the time it probably did, Mr. Strauss had probably passed away. Do you often think, and how do you think about your relationship as having matured at a time when it became impossible to really go back to your teacher and either express gratitude or demonstrate competence?
Are you asking me, or are you asking everyone?
Just how did the Claremont group, how do you think about that? Because it is a little bit different than other people who may have teachers where they can go back and say, express their gratitude or even demonstrate a deeper understanding over the years.
I sometimes think of the questions I was too timid or too stupid to ask it.
I think I can talk to that in a very direct way, because I would distinguish between different stages of the lag in my case. So just very personal way of answering it. When I went to Claremont, I intended to write a dissertation on the American founding, and the early work I did was all focused on that. I was then persuaded by Harry Joffer to learn Greek. And once I learned Greek, I was increasingly enticed. I then took the first class that Professor Strauss taught in the Nicomachean Ethics. It was actually the second class I had taken on the ethics in graduate school. The very first class I took, and that was with Harry Joffa, who was a notoriously bad teacher, although a very brilliant man in some ways. And in that class, the first one, we literally did not get past the second sentence of the first book of the Nicomachean Ethics. 15 weeks and never got to the third sentence. Taking the class on the ethics with Professor Strauss made clear to me this was the first time it had become clear to me that I had to try to figure out what Strauss in the essay on Marsilius calls the cognitive status of the moral virtues. And I decided to write a dissertation about that. And I was nowhere near beginning to write a dissertation when Professor Strauss was there. And when he left, I left. I left to take a first job before I had a dissertation, before I had taken my exams. It was crazy. This could only happen in the 60s. And at that time, I understood from from reading Strauss and from talking to Strauss the paramount importance of the problem of morality or the moral consciousness. And I thought I made great progress in learning about that as I was struggling to write a dissertation and learning from Strauss about that. And it took me a long time to finish my dissertation because I was teaching full time, I became a father. It was a very weird situation. And I wrote hundreds of pages about Aristotle's theoretical books and his practical books and the relationship between his theoretical and practical, all trying to figure out this whole question about the status of morality. But then I was told if I didn't finish my dissertation very quickly, I was going to get fired. And I had this first chapter on Strauss's interpretation of Aristotle. And that became the whole dissertation. And fortunately for me, I was able to complete it in the summer and save my job. Mm-hmm. But, and looking back on the dissertation, from not very long after finishing, when I finished it, I thought, this is not a, it's worthy, even though my teachers were absolutely flabbergasted that I would write on Strauss. And by the way, the only reason I could write on Strauss is because he had died. If he was still alive, I could never have written on Strauss. I never would have even thought about writing on Strauss. So I would have lost my job. And but to come back to this the double lag. So I had made real progress in understanding the problem of morality from starting as an undergraduate thinking about natural right and history as if it was a teaching about moral absolutes and so on. maybe even a teaching about natural law, to seeing that that just wasn't the teaching of natural right and history, and it wasn't the teaching of Mr. Strauss. But what I completely failed to see until after I finished the dissertation was the link between the problem of morality and the problem of religion. I just didn't see it, even though it was right in front of me in all of Strauss's late works. I was so, in other words, so focused on this question of the moral consciousness as it appeared within the horizon of Aristotle's works that I was, I think, in a certain sense, taken in by Aristotle. I just didn't see Aristotle as comprehensively as I should. So I went through at least these two stages of learning from Mr. Strauss over a period of, oh, it must have been 12 years. And I would say, you know, I mentioned my obtuseness. Well, I really do think that for a time there, and it's partly the result of writing a dissertation or writing a book and just being focused, so focused, and not talking enough to people about what you're doing, I was just blinkered. But the blinkers came off, the blinders came off. But that, again, took more time.
We should stop. We will all get a further chance at the final sub-panel. This next panel will be at 2. Coffee will be served in the lobby starting at 1:30, but we really have to stop now. We'll try and give the judge a moment in the last 5 minutes.